Harper Audio presents Mischief by Ed McBain, performed by Len Cariou. The luminous dial of his watch showed 10 minutes past 2 in the morning. The rain had tapered off at about midnight. These writers didn't work in the rain. Didn't want to get their spray cans all wet. The wall he'd chosen tonight was a new one. You could almost smell the fresh cement. New walls attracted these writers the way honey did bears. He was standing here waiting for someone to show up. This was a two-lane street here running under the highway. Your writers always picked a street or a road with traffic on it, so every time you went by, you could ooh and ah over the terrific mess they'd made of the wall. This was the 23rd of March, a dreary Monday morning. Walking in the cold, dank rain, he had worked out his plan. Tonight would be the first of them, if anybody showed. If not, he'd do it tomorrow night. No rush at all. Get it done in time enough. Three of them altogether. One plus one plus one. He figured these writers had to do their dirty work at night. Probably scouted a new wall during the day, came back to mess it up. If anybody showed tonight, he'd catch him in the act. Bam! The gun in the pocket of his coat was a .38 caliber Smith & Wesson. Well, come on, he thought. Can't stand out here all night, can I? His gloved hand felt warm around the pistol. One plus one plus one again. Then retire. Thing was, he was beginning to realize this might take longer than he'd figured. No way of telling when or even if anybody would show. Wait in the dark till... Hold it. Coming up the street. Hands in his pockets. Kid of 17, 18, looking this way and that. Had to be up to some kind of mischief. The kid took a flashlight from his pocket. Light splashed onto the new cement wall. His face cracked into a grin. Then he reached inside his jacket and took out a spray can of paint and stood back from the wall a moment, deciding where to start his masterpiece. He was spraying red paint onto the wall, spraying an S and a P and then an I and then a D, when he heard a movement behind him and turned sharply and saw a man, a gun in his hand. "Here," the man said, and shot him twice in the face. The boy lay still and silent on the ground. He shot the boy one more time, in the chest this time, and then he reached down to pick up the can and squirted red paint all over the boy's face, oozing blood. His chest oozing blood. Red paint and red blood mingling. During the empty hours of the night, the rain had changed to snow. It was that kind of spring. At 9 o'clock that morning, it was still snowing. Andy Parker was looking over the report on the dead graffiti writer. The paper told him Baker 1 had found the kid early this morning under the river highway on North 11th. Kid's name was Alfredo Herrera, street name Spider. That's what he was probably trying to write on the wall, Spider, when somebody pumped two into his face and another in his chest and painted him red for good measure. Served him right, Parker thought, fucking writer, but didn't say. We supposed to inform next of kin on this or what? He asked no one. Unless they already did, Carella said. That's why I'm asking, Parker said. Willis typed this up. Did he already call whoever or what? What does it say there? Doesn't say anything. I hate to call some kid's mother, tell him he's dead. Yeah, well, learn how to do it. Carella said. Thanks a whole fucking lot, Parker said and pulled out a worn telephone directory. Probably be 10,000 people named Herrera this city. As it turned out, he was mistaken. There were only 146. 146 fucking names that would take him all fucking day to call. For what? To tell some lady who couldn't speak English that her shithead son was dead, which it served him right anyway? Sometimes he wished he wasn't so dedicated. He hit pay dirt on the 44th number he tried. He considered this fortunate. The woman's name was Catalina Herrera. When he asked her if she had a son named Alfredo Herrera, she said,
"Yes, I have. Is something..."
"Birth date, September 14th?
"Yes, what?"
"He's dead," Parker said. He told her where the body was, asked her if she could meet him there later to make positive identification, and then told the other detectives he was heading out for lunch. "Nice bedside manner you got there," Carella said.
"Thanks,"
Parker said, and went out smiling. Meyer went to answer the telephone ringing on his desk.
87th Squad, Detective Meyer," he said.
He listened, then, "For you, Steve, on 4. Carella hit the 4 button on his desk extension and picked up the receiver.
"Detective Carella," he said. "How can I help you?"
"You'll have to speak louder," the voice said. "I'm a little hard of hearing." Detective Lieutenant Peter Burns told the three of them they'd already spent too damn much time on it.
"I don't care if it's the deaf man again. I don't want another minute wasted on his damn tomfoolery."
What time did he call?" "Around noon," Carella said. The three detectives, Carella, Meyer, and Kling, were standing around Burns' desk.
"What'd he say?"
Burns asked. "He said he missed us," Carella said.
"Missed us,"
Burns repeated blankly and shook his head. Years ago, he might have welcomed the appearance of the deaf man as a lively diversion. But now, well, the deaf man might still represent challenge, if only his infrequent appearances didn't cause the lieutenant's men to behave like bumbling buffoons. Whenever he arrived, they seemed unable to predict what he was planning, even though he gifted them with lavish clues.
"What else did he say?" Burns asked.
"He said it had been a long time." Burns said, and nodded sourly. "But he knew how much we loved him."
"Sure.
And he knew we would welcome him back with a song in our hearts."
"Oh, no question."
"He also said we wouldn't have to wait too long to make fools of ourselves this time." "What'd the CID show?" He was referring to the caller identification equipment that had been installed on every desk. No need to trace a call anymore. You knew the caller's number at a glance.
"Out-of-state number," Meyer said. "A cellular phone listed to Mary Callender."
"Did you try the number?"
"I tried it," Carella said. "Got a message saying the mobile customer had traveled beyond the service area."
"Meaning he turned off the power. How about the woman?"
Carella said, "She told me the cellular had been stolen from her car yesterday."
"Naturally. So, he's using the stolen phone. Used it once, anyway. He'll probably use a different one next time he calls."
"I don't want you answering." "How can we not answer? Then hang up the minute you know it's him."
"Then we'll never get him, Pete."
"I don't care if we get him."
"What else did he say?" "That's all he said."
"Didn't he tell you his name?"
Burns asked, thinking he was making a little joke.
"Yes, he did," Carella said.
"He gave you his name?"
Burns said, astonished.
"He said, you can call me Samson."
"Samson?"
Samson, with an N. He spelled it out for me. S-A-N-S-O-N.
Samson. Look it up."
"We did," Kling said.
"All 5 directories," Meyer said. "There are 12 Samsons in the..."
"No," Burns said. "No!
Damn it! I won't have you tracking down these people. This is another goddamn game he's playing. If he calls again, hang up!"
"I was just thinking," Carella said. "The 1st of April is only 9 days away."
"So?"
"April Fool's Day," Carella said. The man standing on the bow of the 32-foot Chris Craft was tall and blonde and suntanned, and there was a hearing aid in his right ear. He had chartered the boat under the name Harry Gimpard. Say it over and over again, Harry Gimpard, Harry Gimpard, Harry Gimpard, and it became hearing impaired. The building the deaf man was watching was close to Isola's northern shore, a structure shaped somewhat like a very large Quonset hut, constructed of concrete. Affixed to the top were the stainless steel letters, Department of Sanitation. He had begun watching the building on the 15th of January, trying to determine if anything but Sanitation Department personnel and vehicles would be here on any days but
the first Saturday of each month. During all that time, he had seen nothing but the department's employees and the hulking trucks they used until the first Saturday in February, when at last he was rewarded with the sight of police department vehicles and blue police uniforms. Today was the 23rd day of March. The police would not assemble again for their little monthly ritual until the 4th of April. The deaf man was not expecting much of a crowd on the 4th of April. Just enough policemen to supervise the job and to record the happening. He took the binoculars from his eyes. He would check the facility once again next week to ensure that the routine was, in fact, unchanging. Then, on April 4th, he would be here for the monthly festivities. Until then, there was much to do.
What I don't like is this is a freebie gig we're doing. And it's only 12 days away, and we're getting no coverage at all on it, Jeeb said.
Jeeb was the lead rapper in the group. There were four of them all together, Jeeb and Silver and the two girls, Sophie and Grass. The group called itself Spitshine. It was Jeeb who'd thought up the name. Jeeb remembered his grandfather telling him they used to use the word shine to describe people of color. Jeeb figured it'd be good to throw that word right back in Whitey's face, but attached the word spit to it, so it came out Spitshine, like a black man snarling and spitting, which is what their music was all about anyway. Silver took that name, Spitshine, and turned it into a rap. Was Spitshine the song that made a household name of Spitshine the crew? Silver never let Jeeb forget it was him who'd written that song. That was 4 years ago. Spitshine was now famous enough to do a free concert in Grover Park, sponsored by a chain of citywide banks called First Bank.
I agree with Jeeb, Sophie said. The bank gets tons of publicity, but so far there's still nothing about us performing.
Other crews getting all the splash, Silver said.
Actually, he didn't have his mind on what they were talking about. He'd recently come across an album of Calypso songs written by a singer who'd been murdered and wanted stuck in his mind. He'd rapped the song for Sophie, just rapped out Chatterton's lyrics. Sophie hadn't much liked the song, which was titled Sister Woman. As she argued with Jeeb now, Silver went over the Chatterton lyrics in his mind. Good hip-hop, for sure. The album sleeve had credited copyright to Chloe Productions, Incorporated. He wondered who the hell that was.
Silver, you with us?
I say we call First Bank and tell them we're out of this thing entirely, lest they take a big ad headlining us.
Grass very softly said,
That's the onlyest way, Silver,
and smiled at him. Jeeb wondered if something was going on between these two. Catalina Herrera was in the waiting room of the Morehouse General Hospital morgue when Parker joined her. Catalina was in her late 20s, early 30s, Parker guessed, a diminutive woman with large brown eyes, dark hair, and major hooters. Sobbingly, she told Parker that the kid on the slab in there was her son.
He was a good boy, she said,
which is what they all said. Parker had already done a computer run on the late Alfredo Herrera, and the kid was clean, albeit dead. Parker wondered if his mother knew how handy he'd been with a spray can. He also wondered if her son had been into anything that might have invited two big ones in the face and another one in the chest. He decided to ask her to have a cup of coffee with him. He was thinking he might try taking her to bed. Those boobs. Parker thought women found him irresistible. In the coffee shop, Parker asked Catalina if she knew what her son was doing out in the middle of the night last night, which was presumably when he got shot.
I don't know what he was doing, she said.
Thick Spanish accent that Parker found attractive on these Latino women. When's the last time you saw him? He asked.
When I come home from work, she said. Sis 30.
Very charming. Made him think of guitars and black lace. Made him think of fucking her, too.
We had supper together.
Lilting to the ear, lovely. He wondered if she'd ever made love in English. He almost asked her. Instead, he said, What'd you talk about during dinner?
He told me he wanted to buy a car.
Does he have money to buy a car?
His grandmother left him money,
Catalina said.
Did he belong to a gang?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.